Arvind Kannan, more popularly known as Arvind Animal Activist, is an animal rights activist from Tamil Nadu. He was born on 22nd of July 1992 in Tirunelveli. Arvind, who was once a child who showed immense amount of compassion towards animals, surprisingly began to steer away from his innate nature as he stepped into his teens. He began consuming all sorts of animal products despite being raised in a staunch Brahmin family. After completing his course in French literature, he secured a job in Amazon and worked there for 3 years as a catalog associate. Everything was going as planned till one day when Arvind casually decided to watch a video without knowing that this is about to change his life forever. The video revealed the shocking reality of how animals were slaughtered and killed to be used as food and clothing by humans. From that moment on, Arvind decided to go vegan. He then took it upon himself to spread the message of veganism as far and wide as possible. He soon quit his job and began doing full-time activism, where he delivered lectures in schools, colleges, and interacted with people on the streets and also created videos for social media. He has received hundreds of testimonials from people world over, thanking him for his noble deed and for having helped them to go vegan too. His aim now in his life is to create a revolution in India by bringing awareness about veganism to the masses on a very large scale. He intends to awaken the compassion in each and every one of us, which lies dormant due to societal conditioning.
Namaste, dear viewers. A very warm welcome to Go Vegan, a concept, an ideology that definitely needs a lot of celebration. So what is being celebrating of veganism? So how do we idealize this concept? And how to celebrate and how to propagate is what veganism and especially Go Vegan is all about. To shed more light on this, we have animal activist and a staunch vegan himself, Mr. Arvind Kannan. Let's welcome him. Namaste and a very warm welcome to you.
Namaste. Thank you.
What is like being celebrating veganism? How do you celebrate this?
So being vegan, basically, it's an ideology where one understands that animal life is not beneath human life and that humans are not more special than animals. And it's also an understanding that we should not be using and abusing any animal on earth for our selfish needs or for any reasons, actually. So in that regard, a person who is a vegan lives a life without consuming any animal products. There is no meat, cheese, milk, eggs, honey, doesn't wear any leather, wool or silk, doesn't use any cosmetics that involve the testing of animals, that doesn't use any animals for entertainment like a horse ride or going to a circus or to a zoo, and also doesn't use any animals for cultural reasons, be it for sacrifice or any celebration. Basically, a person who lives their life without using and exploiting animals is a vegan.
Okay. So clearly there has to be some lines marked then. So what is the difference between the use and misuse and manipulation?
Okay, so that's a very good question. So I would say that using any animal or trying to harm any animals apart from the situation of self-defense is wrong. You have the right to defend yourself and your loved ones and where you come from. So in that regard, if there's a conflict between human or animal or human and human, I can understand why violence takes place. But saying that something is tasty, saying that something is their habit or it's part of their culture or it's convenient for them, does not justify harming animals. Because see, we can all agree, I'm pretty sure the viewers, yourself and everybody on earth, if you ask them, do you agree that it is wrong to harm animals unnecessarily? Everyone says yes. Everyone agrees. So now the question is, what is necessary? What is unnecessary? As I stated, if someone says that I feel good because I kill or harm somebody else, which means it tastes good. Because many people, I ask them, why do you eat meat? Why do you eat cheese? They say it tastes good. But does that taste, that few seconds of pleasure we get on our tongue, does that justify hurting someone else? Like, getting happiness out of hurting someone is not justifiable. That is not necessary by any means. Mm-hmm. And if I can show to you and everybody else, the viewers, that you do not need to eat animal products to be healthy. And in fact, if you are a vegan, you would be much more healthy. It's not necessary either as a food. Next, if I show you that you can live a happy, healthy life without using these animals as entertainment or as clothing, and we have alternatives and everything, then what is the reason to not be a vegan? I mean, the question is not why are you a vegan? The question is why are you not a vegan? Because okay, we can live a happy, healthy life without harming, without needlessly harming animals. So in that regard, what is needless, what is necessary, you ask? If an animal harms you, you have the right to defend yourself. But apart from that, there is no justification for harming any animal on earth.
So it's just that giving equal space to all the beings.
Exactly, equal space. Because again, that's a very important thing I want to highlight right now. Veganism does not, I encourage people to be loving to animals. I encourage people to be caring to animals, to feed strays. I'll encourage that. Veganism has nothing to do with being kind to animals. Veganism does not require you to love animals. In the same way, human rights or women's rights. See, I support women's rights. That doesn't mean I know every woman on earth. That doesn't mean I love all of them equally. It's not like that. I realize and recognize that I have no right to harm another woman. I have no right to harm another child. I have no right to harm another animal. It's recognizing that we should not hurt. It's like ahimsa. Our core values in our culture, ahimsa, is definitely a part of veganism. Because it's not about helping, it's about not hurting. That's the whole point.
So ahimsa is definitely the paramadharma.
I see it that way, yes. I personally.
So if we actually go by those lines, yes, then definitely veganism should be the way of life.
Definitely, yes.
Okay. Throughout the civilizations,
yes,
a human normally domesticates either for their need or greed,
yes,
either by nature or nurture. So how do you conceptualize this? Because civilizations always have domesticated.
Correct. You're right.
Different animals to our
use. So I would like to first say that domestication in and of itself, it's a violation of an animal's rights, because domestication sounds like a very beautiful word on paper. It sounds like, oh, we are humans, we live together with animals and we are in this together mutually. That's all a lie. That's completely false. It's completely wrong. It's just embellishing the ideology, but it's not showing the horrors that happen behind the scenes. In fact, look at it this way. If animal slavery, which is what it is, and again, I want to first make this concept very clear so people understand why I make comparisons between humans and animals, because people don't like it if you compare. In fact, comparing a human to an animal is degrading. If you call someone an animal, it's actually an insult. So I'll first explain why I'm doing this comparison. It's because humans and animals are not that much different, if in fact any different at all. They both feel pain and suffering. I understand that if someone were to hit me or someone were to cut my hand, the pain I'd feel here is the exact same pain a horse, a goat, a cow, a chicken, or any animal would feel. You cannot say that a human feels more pain than an animal. That's not true. Number two is, if you were to keep a human in a cage, locked up, that human would want to get out and be free. If you keep an animal, the reason why we keep animals locked up in cages and tie them up is because we know if we untied them, they'd run around free, because that's what they want to do. So when it comes to desire to live free and the ability to feel pain and suffering, and when it comes to how much we care for our young ones and our family, like we love our family, we love our children, everything. Do you think that by any chance a mother animal would love its child less than we love our children? That is absolute. That's the whole point I'm telling you. The thought that humans are somehow superior, we are not. We are exactly the same in that. So in that regard, what I'm trying to say is, if we are saying that, if you feel that when I say domestication is a violation, think of it this way.
Dear viewers, let's get to know more about veganism and the ideology to propagate from Mr. Arvind Kannan after a very short commercial break. Welcome back to Go Vegan. We have a very staunch vegan himself and an animal activist, Mr. Arvind Kannan.
Many people hundreds of years ago took Africans from Africa on a boat to North America and kept them there, and they could have used the word domestication. But that simple word domestication, they tried to embellish slavery. A slave trade was happening between humans, like now it's happening for animals. But that doesn't make the action justifiable. Domestication is very, very, very wrong. It's not, we don't have the right to do this to them.
Is the word itself wrong, or it's just mere violation of their existence?
I have a problem with the action, not the word. I don't care about any language or any words people use. I don't care about any beliefs people have. I care about their actions. Because in the end of the day, no matter what, if I am supposedly, let's say, a crazy person, but I will never hurt anybody. No matter what I yell on the street, whatever I go and scream, makes no difference to the world. It's just me screaming, ah, he's the crazy guy. But if I am the silent one, but I'm a serial killer, that's a problem. So I have a problem with people's actions. I don't care if people say domesticated or not domesticated, what language they use. But the fact that they consume meat, cheese, milk and eggs, the fact that they wear leather, woolen, silk, that's what bothers me.
Okay.
Their actions bother me, not their words.
Okay, so that is where probably they say action speaks louder than words.
Exactly.
So we need to mend our ways that way.
Exactly.
Can domesticate never be like something similar to that, a synonym of living in harmony? No.
See, you can. I can definitely give you examples where humans and animals do live in harmony, especially if you look at, there are two species. First is dog, Canis lupus familiaris. This animal and humans have been living together for thousands of years. and they do seem to live together quite nicely. That if you notice, there's actually a sync between humans and dogs. We can kind of feel and understand what they think, and they can do the exact same to us. But that still does not give us the right to breed them. Now, if I were to take a female dog and tie her up and force a male dog to mate with her, then steal her puppies and sell them on eBay, well, that's very wrong. But if I found a stray dog on the street and she's suffering, and I can take her in my house, give her some food, give her medicines, make her feel comfortable until she dies, that's fine. I have no issues in people adopting animals. In that regard, you can adopt an animal as your friend. The word pet, I personally don't like it, because pet owner, pet, like, you know, again, you own the animal.
We own.
Again, being honest though, I don't care about the word. I personally don't use the word, but I don't mind if people do. The thing is, you shouldn't be breeding animals into existence, be it for anything, for entertainment, for food, for clothing, as pets. Don't breed them. If you find an injured animal or an injured human or a suffering human, who, like an impoverished child, help them. If you can help someone, help them. But I'll make one thing very clear. You don't have to help anyone in this world to be a vegan. By being vegan, you're not helping anybody. You're just preventing future animals from being born into the vicious cycle of torture and death. That's it.
Okay.
Vegans don't help animals. By me being vegan, I've helped zero animals in my life. But I've prevented many from being born and suffering in this world.
Okay. So domestication leads to a lot of other complications.
It does.
Because that brings violation of the animal.
Exactly. Exactly.
And also it brings breeding into the concept.
Yep.
And then because of the need, of the demand,
yes,
they go through many other processes, which is so cruel.
That's exactly the whole thing. Yes.
Okay. So domestication and harmonious living doesn't actually always sync, apart from the canine, the dogs.
Yeah, the dogs and cats, again, if they come into our streets, let's do that. But let's not breed them, is what I'm saying. Let's not, again, cage them. Let's leave them free. If you want to have a pet, if you will say, adopt a stray. Don't go and buy from a breeder. But apart from that, cows, chickens, pigs, fish, goats, ducks, sheep, these animals have nothing to do with us. Like, they, to be honest, they don't. You can just try approaching a goat or a cow on the street. They'll walk away from you. They hate us because they know who we are. They know what we do to them. They know we hit them. They know we kill them. They are not stupid. They very well understand what's going on. So they don't want our company. So let's just leave them alone. Just like, see, look, a simple example. If there's a bunch of, right now, kids playing in the playground, I can go and ask them, do you want to play with me? They'll be like, no, we don't want to play with you. I can go and force them, no, play with me. Similarly, like, stop bothering the animals, just leave them.
Okay.
My biggest hope is we can just leave them alone. That's it, just leave them alone. They'll be fine. They can take care of themselves. They've been here before us, they'll be fine. Just leave them alone.
Just like the way we exist, they also can exist.
Humans, let us exist with our own species, humans. Let cows live with cows. Let monkeys live with monkeys. We live with ourselves without bothering others. That's it.
Okay, so caging or putting anything into confinement,
yes,
is like,
yes,
a basic violation of
exactly,
existence.
Exactly.
So that we shouldn't be doing about. I just wanted to ask one thing. See, a culture, food.
Yes.
Is the same, because food itself is a culture.
Correct, you're right.
So how difficult it would be for you to make people understand, to get into the concept and tell them, no, this is the right way and you need to make these changes, because food itself is a culture.
You're right.
Very much part of all religion, spirituality, everything.
So the beautiful thing about being a vegan activist in India is our traditional food is by default, it is 90% is already vegan. Idli, dosa, chutney, sambar, puri, masala, chapati, kurma, poha, upma, pongal, kichadi, uttapam, idiyappam. This is all vegan. Lemon rice, coconut rice, coriander rice, tomato rice, pudina rice, tamarind rice, veg biryani, veg fried rice, chaswan noodles. This stuff is vegan. Even the samosas, your pani puris, everything we eat and everything we get, 90% of our food is vegan. All you have to do is take that 10%, or what is this 10%? We have morning chai.
Dairy.
Evening chai. With curd rice once a day, and most people once a week non-veg. That's the usual thing for Indians. So all I'm saying is, instead of that morning chai, why don't you use homemade coconut milk? You can use almond milk. If you can afford it, you can buy soy milk. And these things, and people ask me, okay, wait, if I make with coconut milk, let's say coffee or tea, will it taste the exact same? And I'll tell them, listen, you know what? It may not taste the exact same as you've been enjoying all these years. You might get a slight variation, like 20% off. But is that 20% off on your taste buds a justification to cage someone up for their entire life, then make them give birth, take their children from them and kill all of them? Is that 20% of taste on my tongue worth it? Definitely. I personally feel no way. I don't think my life is worth more than someone else's life, especially my taste buds worth more than someone else's life. So no, you can do that easily with coffee and tea. You can make beautiful curd with peanuts. I just take some peanuts, soak them overnight. Next day in the morning, I rinse them, put them in a blender, and then I strain all of it. So you get some peanut milk. I boil it on the stove just like normal milk.
Okay.
And then I keep it for cooling. I take green chilies, the top, the crown of it. I put six of them inside and close it. Next day morning, I see it is curd. Thick, creamy peanut curd. Now, when you first taste it, it tastes like peanut. But when you mix it with rice and eat with some pickle, it tastes just like normal curd. So you can get all your favorite textures and flavors and everything as a vegan if you like eating non-veg. You know soya meal maker, that soy chunks? You just have to boil them slightly, add all your favorite chicken masala. By the way, chicken masala, fish masala, they're all just masala. They contain only plants. No fish or chicken is actually in the masala. So mix that with your soy chunks and eat it. It tastes just like non-veg. So you're not giving up anything actually.
But then why do they label it as with the red or the green dot?
Which one?
Do they contain traces of...
They do not.
Then why would they label it as...
So we make sure when we buy any sort of processed food, we always read the ingredients. And more often than not, all these masalas are all... If you notice, meat by itself doesn't actually have any flavor. Now, if you take raw... What is meat? It is actually speaking the dead, decomposing flesh of someone who wanted to live. That's what the actual thing it is. It's like if I died and someone took my flesh off and kept it in a supermarket next to beef or chicken, you wouldn't know the difference. You wouldn't know anything. How would you know it's human flesh or not? It all smells. It's just flesh. However, when you put very tasty, delicious plants on top of this flesh, the flesh seems to taste nice. So again, it's the plants that give the flavor, not the meat. The meat just gives the texture. Now, if we can replicate this texture in veg, why not?
Go Vegan continues after a short commercial break. Welcome back to Go Vegan. We have a very staunch vegan himself and an animal activist, Mr. Arvind Kannan.
Definitely.
So the whole point is you're not giving up anything. You're eating good food, you're still enjoying your food, and you're not harming animals in the process. So why not?
So if you have probably so many of alternatives, yes, a plethora of alternatives, yes, for everything that
yes,
we do.
We do.
You know? So then definitely this would it's be possible. The right.
I want to make one thing very clear. Even if we didn't have alternatives, it still wouldn't justify the action. Like let's say, for example, if we did not have alternative to coffee or tea, that doesn't justify me drinking cow milk. In that regard, I must sacrifice it. Again, I wouldn't use the word sacrifice. I would say I had to stop because the meaning of the word sacrifice in English is you're giving up something that belongs to you. That milk never belonged to me. It belonged to that baby cow. So I'm not sacrificing anything. If I had to sacrifice, I can sacrifice my hair. I can sacrifice my life for the country by being a soldier. I can sacrifice my wealth for poor people. But saying I'm sacrificing non-veg for veganism or sacrificing milk is actually a lie. Because sacrifice, as I said, means giving up that you own.
We don't own them.
Yes, that flesh, I know we don't own them. The whole thing. We shouldn't domesticate them. They're not ours. They're not property. They're not things. We don't own them. So we're not. You're just changing a few things in your life. You're not really giving up anything.
Then how different are plants? They also are living beings.
You're right. So here's the thing. Plants are living, but they are not sentient. So veganism, the ideology is that we shouldn't be using or exploiting any sentient being. I said animals because animals are sentient beings. By sentient, it comes from the French word called sentir, which means to feel. So if someone can feel, as I said, humans and animals are the same. We both feel pain and suffering. We both desire to live. If you put them both in a cage, they both want out. Well, if you put a rose plant in a cage and me in a cage, the rose plant's not going to do anything. Because you see, a plant requires a brain and a nervous system in order to react, in order to respond and feel
pain.
Those
emotional centers aren't there.
They aren't there. And the thing is, there's a difference between a reaction and response. Because people say, if you touch me not plant, why is it closing? Why does
it's
the
a
Venus?
Response.
It's not a response. It's a reaction. That's the difference. So the reaction means it's chemical based. When I pour two chemicals together, those two chemicals can maybe dissolve together and form a new one, or they separate into two different ones. That's a reaction. There is no thought process involved here. There is no someone. A good example is if there is sunlight right now falling on my eyes. My eye, the water here will react to the sunlight, so I'll start getting tears. That is a reaction. But me choosing to take my hand up and cover my eyes is a response. So a response requires a thought process, something that's calculated, a motive behind it, and it can only be done by a someone and not a something. Humans are a person, someone. Animals are also someone. Because when you look into an animal's eyes, you don't see a something. You see a someone. There is someone
Life.
Looking back at you. There's someone looking back. When you look at a plant, there is no someone. It's a thing. And similarly, just look at it this way. If I kept a potted rose right now here, and I told you, this plant has kidney stones, would you believe me? You would first ask me, okay, where are the kidneys? Show me. That's the first thing. Because if you need to, in order to have kidney stones, you have to have kidneys. If I say this plant has a heart attack, you wouldn't believe me. Because in order to have a heart attack, you have to have a heart. Similarly, if someone says this plant can feel pain and suffering, I'll say, where is the brain? Where is the nervous system? Because if those two don't exist, you cannot bring them into comparison with animals. And here's the thing. When we talk about human violence and human suffering, let's say we see some horrible stuff happening in the country or in the world, like bomb blasts, terrorist attack, rape cases, murders, mutilations, so many horrible things happen in the world to humans. When any of these cases happens, not one person will say plants feel pain. They will never try to justify human violence by saying plants feel pain.
So do they never feel the pain?
Plants cannot feel pain. It's impossible. That's like saying
they
plants...
They don't have pain sensitivity at all. They don't have emotional centers.
Nothing. They cannot.
Then why is it called as response to stimuli? Why the people don't
they
use react the word
to
react?
They, don't, they react to stimuli. They don't respond to stimuli. They react to stimuli,
okay.
Not respond.
So this probably, this word is what we need to know, because we have always been taught that stomata,
yes,
that opening for,
yes,
touch,
yes,
that always, it's a response to stimuli. That, no, is how we've been taught.
That's how
texts.
It was. See, in a touch me not plant, what happens is, so this is the leaf. There's a part called the pulvinus, which is where like this is the base of the leaf. When you touch the leaf, due to the reaction of your touch, so you don't have to touch it, you can even blow it, you can show excessive heat, it'll also do the same thing. It's not responding to the touch, it's reacting to the stimulus, that is the water in the leaves being going down the pulvinus. See, a leaf is firm because there's water in it. When the water is released, it becomes flaccid.
Okay.
That's what happens to it. Similarly, for a Venus flytrap or any carnivorous plant, they have pressure points. And when they feel something, again, they feel in the sense that they react to that pressure point. When the insect puts its foot on the plant, it reacts to that and closes. There,
okay,
is no thought behind it. You can put your finger, think of it this way. Even if you put a stick, it'll close. If you put your finger, it closes. It doesn't think like, okay, I eat human finger, I eat stick. No. It'll close regardless of what you put on. You put a rock, it closes.
Okay, so probably the word, the differentiation, we need to know a,
yes,
lot of things. What actually happens and how it works. Because,
yes,
we have always been taught it is
response
to stimuli.
Yes.
But it is actually reaction.
You're right,
that
you're
takes
right.
Place.
And we have to, if you don't mind, I would like to go on this topic just a little further. Because people really need to know the response. Because this answer, this question that plants feel pain, is one that really disturbs me. Because it is very, very, to be honest, when people say this, they say it only when they argue to a vegan. I'm telling you again, nobody brings up the fact that plants feel pain when we talk about human rights. Then why are they bringing it up when we talk about animal rights? It's because humans eat and wear animals, they also eat and wear plants. And just because they do that to both, they think both are equal. But that's not how science works. If you look at the classification in the kingdom, it's animal kingdom, plant kingdom,
yes,
microorganisms. Only the animal kingdom has sentience. That is, they have the ability to feel pain and suffering. There are a few animals who don't have a brain or a nervous system, like clams, oysters, jellyfish. These animals exist. They don't have a brain or nervous system, but they do have something called a nerve ganglia. That's like a cluster of nerves.
Yes.
And we have nerve ganglia. And they have the remote ability to sense what's happening around them. Even though they don't have consciousness per se, they have the remote senses. A plant has nothing.
Mm-hmm.
A tomato and a child is not the same. A potato and a pig is not the same. It's not. And to say they are the same and compare them is actually frankly disingenuous. It's not honest behavior. Just think about it. If you buy a new car or a new scooter, what do you keep under its wheel to inaugurate it? You keep a lemon or a coconut? Nobody will keep a puppy. And if you saw someone keeping a puppy, you would go and say, are you crazy? And they're like, hey, wait, you kept a lemon that day. Don't you know both are the same? You wouldn't accept it then. Or think of it this way. If there's a house on fire right now and I'm a firefighter, and I go inside and rescue the person inside and I bring them out and they're saying, like, please go and save my puppy, it's stuck inside. So I run into the house and I see it's all on fire, there's a small puppy in the corner screaming. But instead of saving the puppy, I suddenly realize that plants feel pain and go to the fridge, I take the tomato, I take the watermelon, I take the cucumber, all the vegetables, and I come to it and say, I'm sorry your puppy died, but see how many plants I've saved. If any firefighter did this, what would we think of them? Crazy? Insane? But he's like, no, look, this watermelon has like 1,000 seeds, has 1,000 lives. Is that sensible? No. We know the difference. The only reason we bring this up here, again, it's because veganism requires us to change something. So this is the honest truth that I have seen in this world, sadly, is when people have to, everybody wants to change the world. I've seen that. But nobody wants to change themselves. Sad truth.
So it's all in the mental condition.
It is exactly that. Because when I put the responsibility, if I told them, hey, animals are suffering, give me 100 rupees, I'll stop it. Yeah, take. Easy. Animals are suffering, just say you support me. Okay, I support you. Go. Please feel bad for animals. I feel bad for them. Go. I'm done. Please change for the animals. Oh, I'm sorry, plants feel pain. Any way to escape from the responsibility. That's
it's
the whole
escapism.
Thing. Yeah, exactly. Because again, if I were to tell people that they beat elephants in the circus, so don't go to circus, not one person will tell me plants feel pain. If I tell them hunting of animals is wrong, they recently killed like a tiger in Maharashtra.
Yes,
that is wrong. No, not one person says plants feel pain. Because they don't have to actually do anything there. They just have to blame someone else. It's very easy to blame someone else. But when it comes to blaming oneself, that's when they say plants feel pain. That's when they try to escape. So that's why I think that's a very disingenuous. It's not genuine, the question.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm saying let's not do that. Like, let's not be disingenuous. At least, let's be honest.
So vegan is a way to be, and vegan should be everywhere. Veganism,
yes,
should be everywhere.
For every human, yes.
So, thank you so much
thank
for
you
coming
so much
here
for
and
me.
Giving so much of information, so much of knowledge. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So, this was Go Vegan. Thank you so much. Meet you sometime again in another show. Thank you.